You see, there are two things in the character of God that make the cross necessary: His justice on the one hand and His mercy on the other. Now, when you think about it, these two things are actually incompatible, because justice is giving people what they deserve. Mercy is not giving people what they deserve.
Living Truth viewers appreciate the weekly messages of Charles Price. We'd like to remind you that daily teachings from Charles are available as well. Living Truth offers a daily devotional called My Daily Journey with Christ. We've collected the best teachings of Charles Price and presented them in bite-sized daily readings. Gather the family together to share these short lessons centered around various scripture passages. Take a break during your busy workday to focus on God. Bring the devotional along on a business trip or while waiting to meet friends. Share this booklet with neighbors. Read the Bible verse and enriching article to start or end your day. Each edition contains 1 month of readings, and every entry is a reflection of popular messages by Charles. This monthly devotional is a free gift to you from Living Truth to help you grow spiritually. If you are not on the mailing list, sign up today. To receive your free copy, write to the address on your screen or call +1-416-222-3341, extension 289. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. These readings will encourage you as you walk with God and experience the presence of Christ in your daily life. In Paul's beloved book, Romans, he makes some tough, unashamed statements about salvation, God's sovereignty, judgment, and God's righteousness. Paul wrote the letter to the Romans as a foundation for their faith. Righteousness is the moral character of God. So how's your character? Today's message is called The Cross of Christ.
I'm going to read from Romans 3 and verse 21, and today I'm going to read from the English Standard Version, which is the ESV, Romans 3 and verse 21. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. But there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles also? Yes, of Gentiles also, since God is one. He will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. I don't pretend that is an easy passage of scripture to read and immediately grasp the full significance of what Paul is writing, but I want to look at it this morning, and I believe it will be a gateway of liberty for many of us to understand what Paul is writing there. Let me just very briefly set the context. The last couple of times I have said, as an analogy, that when you go to visit your physician, your doctor, with symptoms that you're concerned about, their most important task is to make a proper diagnosis of what is the cause that lies behind these symptoms. If they do not make a correct diagnosis, they will not be able to offer you a correct remedy. And Paul, in this letter, is giving a diagnosis of the human condition, and we have looked at that diagnosis, and it is a serious situation that he brings to light. He contrasts the righteousness of God, which is the central theme of the book of Romans, with the unrighteousness of human beings. Back in chapter 1, verse 17, he says, in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith. But he concludes in chapter 3, verse 10, looking at the human condition, there is no unrighteous, not even one. Then in chapter 1, verse 18, he speaks about the wrath of God, which is being revealed, from heaven in the present tense there, not will be revealed in the future, but is being revealed and is being expressed in God giving people over, he explains, to the sinful desires of their hearts. What people want to do, he lets them do, and it is an expression of his wrath only in that they, he explains, receive in themselves the due penalty for their perversions. Sin is always poison. But that's not the end of the story. Because then in chapter 2, he talks about the judgment of God, which will be revealed in the future tense now, on the day when God will judge men's secrets through Jesus Christ, he says in chapter 2, verse 16. And when he speaks of this judgment, it's not in the third person as it has been in chapter 1, speaking of the wrath of God on those and them. I think 32 times he speaks in the third person, but now he brings it to the second person. It's the judgment of God on you. About 40 times he uses the second person there. And it's not just on the Gentile, but on the Jew. Not just on those who are outside of the covenant of God, but those who are inside the covenant by implication, not just on unbelievers, but we believers stand also before God. You and I face the judgment of God. That's what Paul says. And then he finishes this section by summarizing our position in this way, in verse 10 to 12 of chapter 3. There is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands, no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one that does good, not even one. Now, this is a depressing diagnosis that he is giving of the human condition. It is depressing news, but we have to understand it. We have to understand what is wrong before we begin to understand what is the remedy. Now, where we began reading this morning, he begins to provide the remedy, which he will continue to explain over a number of chapters, but he begins with the most important foundation upon which that remedy is to be found. In verse 21, he says, but now. Now, those two words are important two words to introduce this new section. But now means that despite this depressing diagnosis of our condition that we must hear and understand and recognize, but now there is another side to this story. But now there is a remedy to this predicament. And he says in verse 21, but now a righteousness from God has been made known. Into this deep darkness of there is no one righteous, not even one, there beams this tremendous light, but now a righteousness from God has been made known. Now, notice the words, they are important. A righteousness from God. So we immediately know he is not saying, dig deeper into yourself, dig deeper into your resources, dig deeper into your ability to do something well. He says, no. This is a righteousness that comes from outside of yourself. It is from God and completely unrelated to any capacity within yourself. Now, that's exciting news. But what does he mean and how does it work? I want to talk about this under two simple headings. I want to look first at a problem that has to be addressed. And this problem is something we'll see in a moment within the Godhead himself, within the Trinity. And then secondly, we'll talk about a provision that has to be applied. We have to do something in response to this, and I'm going to ask you and challenge you to do something this morning in response to this truth. First of all, the problem has to be addressed. There's a huge problem in the middle of this dilemma that Paul begins to write about here that is summed up in several remarkable contradictory statements. Here's one of them, verse 23 into 24. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift. Now, here's a contradictory element here. All have sinned and yet are justified. Now, how can it be that those who are described as all have sinned, that includes all of us, at the same time can be described as justified? Or in verse 26, how can he describe God, as he does, as being both just and the justifier? How can God, if he is just, justify those who are declared to be sinners? Because that verse says that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Or in the next chapter, Romans 4, verse 5, how can it speak of God who justifies the wicked? How are the wicked justified? That seems a contradiction in terms. The word justified in my dictionary has various definitions attached to it. One of those definitions includes to be vindicated. Well, how can we say God vindicates the wicked? How can we say that? Another meaning that it gives in my dictionary is that justified is to be justly treated. How can God justly treat the wicked and at the same time vindicate them? That is the dilemma, that is the problem that has to be addressed. The key to this is in second part of verse 22, down to verse 25. And this is what he says. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. Let me try to unpack that important statement. When he speaks of the blood of Christ, of course, he's speaking of the cross of Christ. Now, that statement includes four things. All have sinned. He reminds us of that. All who have sinned may be justified. That's the new ingredient now that Paul is bringing in. Thirdly, it is a gift of God's grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whatever that means. So this being justified is a gift of God's grace. And the fourth thing he says in that statement there is it is made possible by the blood of Jesus being a propitiation. That's the word he uses, and that's the crucial word that we need to understand that is used here. It's not an everyday word. We don't use it normally in everyday conversation. But the word propitiate, again, according to my dictionary, means to turn away wrath. And remember, that is an issue that Paul has stressed, by satisfying its demands and its requirements. My dictionary also says, as another rendering of that, to propitiate is to appease an offended person. That begs the question. If there is an offended person involved who needs to be propitiated, his wrath needs to be turned away, who is that person? And the answer, clearly, is it is God. It is his righteousness that has been Paul's theme. It's his wrath that has been provoked. It is his judgment that we have to face, and that is presented as the key issue that has to be faced. Now, the question then is, who is going to address his wrath? And who is going to satisfy his judgment? And the answer is, Jesus Christ is going to address his wrath and satisfy his judgment by offering his blood as a propitiation. Now then, to understand this, let me ask you a question. For whom did Jesus die? If I were to ask you that personally, for whom did Jesus die? I wonder what you would say to me. Well, you may give a variety of answers. Somebody might say Jesus died for the world. Somebody might say Jesus died for sinners. You might personalize it and say Jesus died for me. And of course, all of those statements would be true because we are the beneficiaries of his death. But it is not we who make the cross necessary. It is God's need for his wrath to be addressed and satisfied that makes the cross necessary. So in the first instance, Jesus died for his Father. He died for God. He died because God's righteousness and his wrath and his judgment demanded atonement. That's actually the word that the NIV uses. It's a valid word. It's a good word. But it doesn't capture the full meaning of propitiation, that it was God who needed atonement. You see, we don't demand the cross. We don't. We would be perfectly happy for an arrangement that said, as long as you are sorry for your sin, as long as you confess your sin, as long as you repent of your sin, you can be forgiven. Without any need for the cross at all. Wouldn't you be happy with that? As long as you confess your sin and really repent and are really sorry, God will forgive you. We'd be happy with that. When my kids were younger, if they were up to mischief, occasionally, I had a son, so frequently. If he came to me and said, I'm sorry, and I knew that he meant it, I would say, that's great. I forgive you. I don't say, Matthew, that was wrong. One of us is going to have to die for that. Yet God does. We'd be happy for a social arrangement that brings about our forgiveness without the cross being necessary at all. But that is not possible to us because our natural position is that we are under the judgment of God, recipients of the wrath of God, is what Paul has taken time to explain in the earlier chapters. And so the demand for the cross comes from within God himself. And the reason is because God is just. And therefore, because of his just character, it is impossible for God just to forgive sin. In the Old Testament scriptures, it tells us, Exodus 23, verse 7, I will not acquit the guilty. Proverbs 17, the Lord detests acquitting the guilty. The idea, you can go and do what you like, come back, and as long as you say, I'm sorry, you're acquitted, God detests that. Because he is just. And if God could just forgive sin, then surely he would, and the cross would be unnecessary and at best would be extremely extravagant as a gesture towards us if it wasn't in itself addressing fully and satisfying the just wrath of God. So here's the issue. Something has to happen to make it possible for the just one in verse 26 to become the justifier of the ungodly in the same verse without any violation of his justice. Somebody has to propitiate the wrath of God, and there are one of two options. Either you and me, solely on the ground of our own guilt, and we take the consequences, or a sinless substitute, a sinless human being, who because of his own purity and sinlessness is in a position to offer himself as a substitute for those who are sinful. And this, of course, is what happened on the cross, which is why Jesus Christ had to become a man to be representative of you and me, one of us, but sinless, standing between the wrath of God and the sinfulness of every human being. And if I can use this language, and in standing between us, soaking up the wrath of God in himself. Elsewhere in Scripture, 1 John 2, verse 2, John writes, "He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." He is the one who propitiates and addresses the wrath and judgment of God. 1 John 4, verse 10, "In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins." Now, I know this idea of propitiation has been controversial. We don't like the idea of God being angry at all. And we certainly don't like the idea of God's anger needing to be addressed. We have a stereotype of God as being without any negative emotion. He's just love, he's just kind, but he's also just. And justice must have the capacity for wrath to be provoked when injustice is carried out. And the heart of what Paul is saying here is that if in his justice he is not permitted to acquit the guilty simply because he wants to, then the only grounds on which we may be acquitted is that the Lord Jesus Christ takes the consequences of our sin upon himself and satisfies the just wrath of God, so that as a result, you and I can be acquitted. In the words of chapter 4, verse 5, the ungodly can be justified. You see, there are two things in the character of God that make the cross necessary. His justice on the one hand and his mercy on the other. Now, when you think about it, if God is just as he is, if God is merciful as he is, these two things are actually incompatible, because justice is giving people what they deserve. That's justice. Mercy is not giving people what they deserve. Now, how is it possible to be just and merciful at the same time? You might say, well, mercy might cause you to come halfway. So instead of giving the full penalty that the justice demands, you simply go halfway and say, well, learn a lesson from this and just take a little bit. You might say you can reconcile somewhere in the middle. But then it would neither be just nor would it be merciful in its entirety. We cannot apply justice and mercy to the same person at the same time for the same crime. We can't do that in a court of law. Let me illustrate. Just supposing I drove my car down Shepherd Avenue outside this building at 100 kilometers an hour. It's never free enough to do that. But supposing I did, and the limit is 50. Is it? 60. What is it? 60? Oh, wow. I can do another 10 kilometers on there. All right. And I drive down there at 100 kilometers an hour. I'm pulled over. I elect to go to court, and I stand in front of the judge there, and he says, are you guilty or not guilty of driving your car at 100 kilometers an hour in a 60-kilometer zone? And I say to him, I'm guilty. He's got all the evidence anyway. So I come clean, I'm guilty. Now he can do one of two things. He can say, I'm going to fine you $300, whatever the going rate is. I don't actually know. Brian, do you know? You don't? Sure? Let's think of it. That's $300. He can deal with me justly. Fine $300. And I pay the fine and I go. Or he can deal with me mercifully and say, look, I understand you're in a hurry and you don't do this very often. Just don't do it again. You're free. But he can't do both. He can't satisfy legal justice and also at the same time show me mercy. He can do one or the other, but not both. God is both just and both mercifully. How does he remain just and how does he remain mercifully without compromising either? Because Jesus, who had no sin of his own, stepped into the situation and on the cross, he was saying, in effect, as the Father looks at me, he sees Charles Price and all the wrath of God against my sin, all the judgment of God upon my sin. He, as my substitute, is taking it all. It was as if he were me, and having paid in full, it becomes as if I were he. That is, I am now declared righteous as he is righteous. So what Paul is meaning, but now a righteousness from God. You've been declared righteous. Because the justice of God has been satisfied in the person of Jesus Christ regarding my sin. Justice has been satisfied. When you confess your sin to God and you ask him to forgive you, do you appeal to his justice or do you appeal to his mercy? Please forgive me. Are you asking to be merciful, Jesse? I asked you that question because I thought you might get it wrong. And actually, you did get it wrong. And it is a very significant getting it wrong. And I'll tell you why. Do you know 1 John 1 verse 9? You know what that says? It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen. You see, because Jesus Christ has met in full the just demands of God, the grounds on which he forgives us is his justice. If I may put it this way, he is legally, morally obligated to forgive us. Why? Because Christ has paid for it. That's why we're not described as being mercified. There's no such word, but we are described as being justified, and that's a very beautiful word. Justice has been satisfied. Now, this is very important. You know, many of the liturgical churches will go through a period of confession as part of their services, and the response to that confession, which is repeated a number of times in the service, is, Lord, have mercy, Christ, have mercy. And I understand fully the humility that lies behind that appeal. We deserve nothing. And behind the cross of Christ is the mercy of God, of course, and the love of God, of course. It was in mercy that he came to be our substitute. But the grounds on which we are forgiven is the justice of God. You see, if you appeal to his mercy, it is very likely you'll come to a point where you've confessed something repeatedly. And you'll say to yourself, I've confessed this at least 100 times. to God, and this is the 101st time, surely he's not going to forgive me again. Surely I've exhausted his mercy. If you're appealing to his mercy. Let me illustrate this. Supposing you leave the church here one Sunday, and you're driving home, and you're just desperate for a cup of coffee, and you pull in at a coffee shop, and you go in, and you say, I would love a cup of coffee, please, but I've got a problem. And my problem is that I forgot to bring any money with me. But would you give me a cup of coffee? They'd say, well, sir, we're not running a charity here. Maybe go to the Salvation Army, you might get one, but here, no, I'm sorry, we charge you, we're business. Yeah, but it's a cup of coffee I'm talking about. I mean, don't you empty the pot every 20 minutes to make sure it doesn't get stale? I mean, how much do you pour down the drain? You must pour down gallons down the drain. Just give me a cup. It doesn't have to be large, it can just be medium. Just give me a cup. No, but just this once, go on, please. And there's a lineup behind you now, so the guy says, all right, just, I gotta deal with those other customers. Here's your cup of coffee, don't tell anybody. And you go and sit and enjoy your cup of coffee, that's great. Next week, you come to church on the way home, you dying for another cup of coffee, and you pull into the same coffee shop, and you go up to the counter, and you say, I'd love a cup of coffee. Yeah, I remember you last week, actually. Yeah. I hope you got some money. Well, no, as a matter of fact, I didn't bring any money with me this time either. I'm sorry, we're not giving you another cup of coffee. Listen, you gave me one last week. Did it hurt you? Did you lose your job? Did you go bankrupt? Come on, as I told you last week, you pour how much down the drain every day because it's 20 minutes old? Give me a 19-minute old cup of coffee if you have to. Listen, I told you last week, we're a business. We don't just give away cups of coffee. Yeah, but once, come on. Well, twice. You did last week. I know, you're very kind. I mean, you're a lovely person, actually, because you gave me one last week. Go on, give me one. And there's a lineup building already. So he says, look, last time, here's your cup of coffee. You take and enjoy your cup of coffee. Third week, you're on your way home. You pull in the coffee shop. And as you walk through, he says, uh-oh. And you say, yeah, I'd love a cup of coffee, but, you know, I forgot to bring money again. I put it all in the offering at the church. Listen, chum, get out of here. I'm not going to give you cups of coffee every week for nothing. You see, you're appealing to his mercy. He can give you or he cannot give you. You're just appealing to his mercy. But supposing I know you and I know that you don't carry money and I know you love your coffee, and so I drop into the coffee shop, you know, on my way in on that first Sunday, and I say, I've got a friend who's always wanting a cup of coffee, never carries the money. Here's $50. Give him some coffee when he comes in. So you pull up and you go in and you say, I love a cup of coffee, but I'm sorry, I don't have any money with me. I totally forgot. What's your name? Oh, no problem. Here you are. Have a coffee. And he gives it to you. Next week you go in and you say, look, I didn't bring the money again. And you were kind last week. No, that's right. No, I remember you. Yeah, sure. What do you want this time? Have a latte if you like. And you drop in the third week, and he says, I've been waiting for you. Here's your coffee. Have a donut to go with it. Come on. You see, the second time you appeal to his justice. Now listen, I'm making a serious point here, and it's this. When it comes to your sin, there's cash in the till. I don't mean by that, wow, you're free to go and sin as much as you want. Though, I understand, and Paul understands why we might come to that conclusion, because he says in chapter 6, and we'll look at it in chapter 6, shall we therefore continue in sin because grace is so inexhaustible? And he says, of course not. And he gives you reasons. But nevertheless, he only asks a question because he's teaching what I've told you about the coffee. That it's paid. And when you and I come in genuine confession and turning from our sin, and of course confession is not just naming it, it is turning from it. It is recognizing it for the poison that it is. And saying, Lord Jesus, I confess my sin, and you are faithful and just. And you look at me, and you look at Jesus, and you say, it's paid for. Do you know the role Jesus Christ has now on the right hand of the Father? In 1 John chapter 2, it tells us, if we sin, we have an advocate, a lawyer, representing us with the Father, Christ Jesus, the righteous one. What's it say? It's saying, if you sin, and you will, and you come before God, our judge, you have a lawyer, an advocate. His name is Jesus Christ. And he says, Father, Charles Price's sin was covered in full on the cross. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses him from most of his sin? No, all his sin. Actually, if we were to talk about this, there are two advocates, two lawyers. One is Satan. He is called the accuser of the brethren. Book of Zechariah, there's a picture of Satan standing accusing a man called Joshua. And he's dressed in filthy rags, and Satan's saying, this guy claims to be one of your people. And Satan is standing before the Father accusing me. Charles Price, you know, he stands up there in that pulpit. Do you know what he does when no one's looking? Do you know what he's been up to? And the Lord Jesus says, actually, yes, I do. I know exactly what he's been up to. I know every detail. And Father, it's covered. And the Father says, it's covered. And in justice, he says, you're forgiven. Because Jesus endured everything you and I deserve on the cross. And as a result, we are justified. This is such an important word, justified. I've used this illustration before, but one of the best illustrations I know of this word comes from the days when capital punishment was practiced in Scotland. Scotland has a different law to English law, and when a man was hanged, they put a notice outside the prison, and the wording of that notice had to conform to legal requirements. And whatever else it said this, on such and such a date, naming the date of the execution, at Market Cross, Edinburgh, Balliny Prison, Glasgow, wherever the prison was, so-and-so, naming the person, was justified at 9 a.m. What do they mean he was justified? Do they mean he was forgiven? No, justified doesn't mean forgiven. It's got a much deeper meaning than that. What it meant was, at 9 o'clock that morning, when he was executed, all the just requirements of the law were fully, totally, completely met. And this case is, as of 9 a.m., closed. Closed. The judge is on another case. The police have been assigned to other situations. The lawyers have put the books away. And they're on to something else. This case is over. It's over. And legally, should they discover even that it was an execution of the wrong person, they cannot retry the same case again. It's over. When it declares us to be justified, this beautiful word means far more than that we're forgiven. It means the case is over. It's over. And you and I may enjoy the incredible liberty of that because Jesus Christ has satisfied fully the justice of God. But there's a second section, and I'm going to be very brief on this. I intended to be very brief on this. The problem that had to be addressed was God is both the just and the justifier. Well, how does that work? Well, we've tried to understand that. Second thing is the provision it has to be applied. Christ has died historically on a certain day outside the city walls of Jerusalem, but that does not mean an automatic universal salvation. It is true that Christ died for all people, because as we read just now in 1 John 2 and verse 2, he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. There is enough in the sacrifice of Christ to cover the sins of the whole world. But not all people are saved. Why not? Because it has to be appropriated, it has to be applied personally. How do we do that? Go back to the key verse here, chapter 3 and verse 21. But now a righteousness from God, apart from law, has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. This righteousness is by faith and is to all who believe. I'm going to develop that in Romans 4, because Paul does in Romans 4, but I need to say enough for you to enter into the good of it here this morning. You see, if it's by faith to all who believe, we recognize it has nothing to do with our own abilities or the capacity to save ourselves. It is exclusively from putting our trust in Jesus Christ saving us. And in Romans 8 and verse 1, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. No condemnation means God has nothing against you anymore. Why? Because everything he had the right to hold against you, he held against Christ. And therefore, as he held against Christ what he should have held against you, he now holds against you what he held against Christ. What is that? You are my beloved son. And we are accepted, Ephesians 1:6 says, in the beloved. We are loved. We're accepted. We are as loved as much as Jesus is loved by his Father. As much. Because we're accepted in the beloved. We've taken his position. And forgiveness meets one of the deepest needs of the human life, psychologically, spiritually. But the central issue is not just that we're forgiven. That is wonderful. The central issue is we've been reconciled to God. That's the issue. We're reconciled to God. And we're now accepted in him and loved by him. But you know, it's not automatic. If we confess our sins, I've said before a number of times, sin leaves our body through our mouth. We confess it. Elsewhere in Scripture, confession involves repenting of it, turning from it, and turning to and believing in the sufficiency of the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. I will thank the Lord Jesus that all my sin was placed on him. I will confess that I am a sinner. And on the grounds of the justice of God, I will receive his forgiveness, that I might be indwelt then by his Holy Spirit and be equipped to live a new life. I'm going to lead you in prayer. And I am persuaded there will be a number of people here this morning who need to make that transaction. There are some people here this morning, and you have lived without any sense of freedom from your sin. You've been plagued by memory of its guilt, and you need to be liberated from that by believing it's on the grounds of justice that God cleanses you. Christ has paid in full. Let's pray together. And if God has spoken to you, would you pray with me? Lord Jesus Christ, thank you that you died for me. And your blood is sufficient to cover all of my sin. I confess that I'm a sinner. deserving the judgment of God. But you have taken it on yourself. Forgive me. Free me from my sin. Thank you, the Father forgives me because he's just. I ask that the Holy Spirit will come to live in me and give me strength to live a new quality of life that displays your presence in me. Thank you for hearing my prayer. Thank you for coming into my life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel.
Tune in next week for the continuation in this series from Charles Price.
Paul wrote the letter to the Romans as a concrete theological foundation for their faith. The book of Romans reveals the answers to important questions and provides information on many topics such as salvation, spiritual growth, and the righteousness of God. While it's important to understand the teachings inside the pages of Romans, it's life-saving to put them into practice. This series by Charles Price is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen or call +1 416 222 3341, extension 289. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. While it's important to understand the pages of Romans, it's life-saving to put them into practice.
How can I say thanks for the things you have done for me, things so undeserved, yet you gave